So thanks everyone for coming. I'm really excited to talk to you at my first SciPy about small town policing. So why policing? Why do we care about policing? I hope that it's been very obvious over especially the last few years that in the US there is kind of a national emergency about policing. And as data scientists, it's very obvious that to us, we want data and we want to be able to understand what's going on in our world through the lens of data. So one problem is that police actually hide and do not make available a lot of the data that even if they have it, it's not publicly available. And another thing is that policing substantially differs depending on where you live and who you are. So there is an inherent inequity that is here in our system, and there is not data available. So why in particular small towns, right? A lot of us live in big cities and maybe don't think about small town policing. So here is a kind of a good explanation of why we care about this. So this Nature article has this great graph that shows the incidence of police brutality per 100 criminal homicides. So basically, given a town size and a level of general violence in that town, how much of that is at the hands of police? And we can see that for really small towns, it's actually the highest. And as you grow in city size, police brutality decreases. So this is showing that it is actually a more acute problem in small towns than in large cities, even though kind of the narrative and a lot of the news that we see might be surrounding larger places. Okay. So what kind of data is available? There is a lot of data available, and I feel like I need to recognize how much work has gone into collecting this, because some of these are like absolutely massive data sets, and I want to acknowledge. So I have this really technical chart here showing the level of detail and average city size represented in that data set. So these are kind of open source, large agglomerations of data that I'm going to show, and there's a handful of them at different levels of detail. So we have a few that are kind of really small city sizes, but also very low level of detail. And these would be mapping police violence, fatal encounters, police scorecard, for example, and you can check these out online. These would be aggregated data sets. So for example, police scorecard is going to take all of the data that they scraped or found and will report back one number that says, you know, like police violence, police brutality, or like amount of racism in traffic stops or something like this. So there's a very agglomerated level of detail, not specific incident level, but it covers a lot of the US, so most towns are represented, and so the average size of the city is smaller. There is also much more detailed data available that is kind of in open source available repositories, such as Open Policing, Police State Initiative, and some from 538. And this has incident level data. So if you go online, you'll be able to download an entire data set for multiple years, for example, that will have something like traffic stops. And it will show information maybe on demographics, on timing, on who was stopped, for example. But the problem is that these data sets are only available for predominantly large cities. So if you see a really nice scale here, about 600,000 is the average city size represented. So only really big cities are represented. And here, Citizens Police Data Project is only for Chicago. So exact number, not average, but really, really detailed data. And this is kind of like the pinnacle of what's there. Okay, so we have some data available, but not for small cities. And I want to really highlight that. I kind of made this chart to show that the people are living in small cities. They're actually, I think it was 60% of folks in the US live in towns of 50,000 people or fewer. So it's not that everyone lives in large cities. And the distribution of like the size of places in census designated places compared to where the data is available is very skewed. So we have a lot of data available for bigger places, but not for smaller places, literally the size of the city. And a lot of people live there. Okay, so bring in our small town police accountability research lab. So this is kind of like a ragtag team of some data scientists, some lawyers, some social scientists all coming together to address this issue. And we have a couple of goals that are being scaffolded, and we have achieved some work, but a lot of it is ongoing. So our first kind of main goal is to capture some case studies. So given particular instances of small towns, can we go through the process of getting the data, cleaning it up, and kind of analyzing it and coming up with some insights? And we've done some of this I'm going to talk about. We also want to create, of course, a reusable code repository so that other data scientists or researchers could do the same thing on their own towns. This is partially done, but could be beefed up as well. And then more broadly, in the long term, we really want to make a toolkit that anybody could use. So you could maybe send this to your grandmother and she could go online and figure out for her small town what's going on with policing. She would have the ability to kind of follow a pathway to be able to get her own data. And then hopefully kind of like real stretch goal would be to then take all of this data, if everyone is available to access this and get their own data and analyze it, could we create a broader repository so we could kind of create a systemic understanding of what's going on in policing in the US? Also, preface, this is all US centric, so I apologize that I didn't say that before, but just to say. Okay, so of course we need data. How is this toolkit gonna work? We need to gather the data. And in some places, it's going to be really easy, and in some places, it's not going to be so easy. So I'll show kind of three levels of what that looks like. So I live in Seattle, and I can type in Seattle policing data, and I can go on the Seattle Open Data Portal, and there's an API if I want, or I can go and view the data online. You can even visualize it online. It's really cool. And they have very detailed incident-level data across multiple years that will kind of cover all kinds of stuff that we would look at. So if you want to look at particular questions about bias or violence from the police, you would be able to find this data easily and just hit export. Great. But this is Seattle. We're a really big city. What happens in smaller places? So a place like Durham, North Carolina, that has about 50,000 people, they do have a nice online system. You can go and click through and find a specific incident or a specific time of incidents, and you have to click through and get individual PDF documents that are generated automatically. So here you would be able to see in a structured way detailed information, but this is only for one incident. And so you're going to either have to download those all manually or use something like Selenium to crawl through and download those and then kind of agglomerate them. Great. So there was a team separate from our research lab that did this for Durham data specifically, and that's available on our repository. Okay. What happens if you live in a really small town and neither of those options is available? It's really obvious that not everyone has the access to just like publish all their data. It takes a lot of expertise. It takes maybe some money. And so maybe they don't have like an open police data availability in every place. Okay. So what you actually have to do is go ask your police departments. And sometimes this is not really feasible depending on who you are, where you live, and what your experience is with the police. This might not be feasible. So maybe if you're interested in doing this and you don't feel comfortable working with your police department, I would definitely recommend finding an advocate for you, whether it's kind of a legal advocate like the ACLU or just a friend who you trust. You need to start working with your actual police department and contact them. So you need to fill out some forms and you know, make a formal request, email someone about it. Hopefully, if they comply, that's great. But if they don't, you might need to actually submit a FOIA request. So the Freedom of Information Act is a federal law that says that basically anyone who is governing you or ruling over you, you have a certain right to that data. So you're not you're not accessing every piece of data, but if you have an interest in getting data that has to do with you and how you're being governed, you are entitled to that. So you can submit a FOIA request. And maybe if that's not reacted to, you might have to escalate to like the state attorney general's office or something like that. But legally, you are entitled to this information. Okay, you are entitled to it, but that does not mean you're entitled to a nice, tidy pandas data frame, right? So what happens? Maybe there's just a bunch of banker's boxes of printed pages that show up on your doorstep. So this is what actually happened with our collaborators. They asked for some small town data after months and months of back and forth. Even with a cooperative police department that wanted to give the data, it was really an issue of technology. So what happened was they had to hire probably some poor intern to go literally hit print on every single page, because otherwise I think the data would have been on floppy disks if it was available at all. So I think I recall that everything was running on Fortran and it was just extremely outdated and unavailable. So, okay. Here's our three levels of data. We might have something really nice and curated, something in between that maybe the average kind of like undergrad data science major could deal with. And then we have this like extremely messy printed data. So I'm going to go through what we got, how we extracted it. Okay, so our next step is to clean everything up. So here is an example of a scanned in page after all these pages were printed. Out of the 3,844 printed pieces of paper, had to be scanned in manually by some other poor intern probably. And what happens is these get turned into some PDFs, which are going to be actual images, not like highlightable text. So each of these pages gets turned into something like this, and we have lots of call logs. And each call log is going to be identified. You can see like 19-17 in the top with like a unique identifier. And each one is going to have different information. All of it is going to be a little bit grainy and noisy. We have some like pixelated text here. These are, again, just pictures, not actual like text data. We have some nice scanning boundary, like the little, you know, black edge. We have some little schmitz from the printer, and it might be rotated a little bit because someone fed it in just a little bit off kilter. And so in order to kind of pre-process all of these images for further analysis, we can use something like OpenCV. There's lots of, obviously, image processing packages, but this is what we used. I also want to highlight that each of these call logs is going to be slightly different. So if you had, like that Durham data, a full PDF with all available fields and some of them are blank, that's one type of information. But in this case, we have kind of like missing data that we don't know what every type of call log might look like. And this can pose a challenge as well. I'll talk about how we deal with that. Okay, so then we have to go through and do OCR, optical character recognition, in order to turn just the pictures of data into actual usable text data. So we used PyTesseract to interact with Google's Tesseract engine. And what that will do for us is create bounding boxes around each word, and we'll then translate. It'll kind of match what the shapes of the characters look like to a known dictionary. It actually has a lot of languages, so if you're doing this in not English, yeah, I was really impressed with the options available. So it's going to go ahead and try to match all of these words to English words or numbers and translate it into, you know, text data. Okay, that doesn't actually work every time, so you can also provide kind of known information if you want, but it does work remarkably well. What does happen, though, is that especially with this particular structure of data where it's like key value pairs in some of these, but the rest of them are kind of like in a list of values, it's like not the most structured way to look at data. So we do need to reorganize it a little bit. All these bounding boxes get put out with kind of XY locations, so we can order all of those differently. And then we can also look at pattern detection. So if something says four date, two digits, four digits, we might know that that's like month, day, year, and be looking for dates like that. So we can just use regular expressions. And then finally, we're still going to have a lot of misspellings, especially around words that are not just English language words. So a particular street name or a particular person's name, these are not going to get matched very well. And so something like Main Street might need to be corrected. So using fuzzy matching to do that kind of takes a dictionary of known items that you're looking for, like a list of officer names, and then you can kind of match those as close as possible to what might be might need to be corrected. Okay, so now our data is in its final form. We have this nice cleaned pandas data frame that has actually a large amount of information. I'm really impressed with how far we got with this. It's fairly clean and very structured. So what we want to do with it is, of course, ask some questions. And we need to kind of analyze for each particular location, for each particular town, like what is important to us. I'm going to talk about why community is really important to be in contact with and be looking at for those questions. Okay, so I'm also going to preface this with we are not language modelers, but we did some stuff that I think is very cool. So we have all these free-form narratives that have a lot of different structure in them, and given these, what kind of patterns or themes might emerge. So we have these three examples where we have a full text narrative of a traffic incident, where someone's writing just free-form information. We have maybe a short narrative of something else that happened. And then the third example at the bottom is a narrative that's just saying something was checked. So the only words that are available there are checked, cleared, done, things like that. Okay, so from this, we can build a topic model. And this topic model, I know, looks like very fancy. I'm going to explain that on the left, we have individual words that are represented as all these kind of threads drawing across. And so a word might be like vehicle, operator, whatever. And then as those blue lines kind of agglomerate those words together, that forms a topic. And so this is like a hierarchical clustering of how all of those words form commonalities within the text. And in an unsupervised way, we're both going to cluster the topics between words and also specific call logs like 19-189, like a particular incident, into those topics. So this is a really interesting way to look at the data, and it's not really feasible to look at each individual narrative and understand what's going on kind of on a systemic level in a town. So using something like topic modeling to see what themes come up on their own is a really nice way to look at this data. We're also really curious about spatial patterns, like on a map, what's going on? Are there particular neighborhoods that are being affected, or are there themes in who is policing what areas, and can we kind of look at different facets of the data to investigate that? So making just a quick map on a leaflet, we can see like where the incidents are happening, and zooming in, we can kind of just see like exactly on a particular block how many incidents are occurring in there. I also made a map using Altair that will show like filtering for each different officer. So in this map, I'm hesitant to do any actual interaction, but you could click on each particular officer name in this example and filter for that officer to see if there's spatial patterns on where someone might be policing versus others. And this mapping brings up a really important question that really kind of ties back, if you were at the luncheon yesterday, about anonymity. And so the speaker was saying, in particular, if you have very few people of, say, a particular demographic answering a survey question, you don't want that information to be connected too closely, because if you can identify someone's demographics because they're the only person answering that question, you know their answer. So in a similar way, we need to anonymize this small town data, because if there's only one person living on a street, it doesn't matter if you anonymize it by block because they're the only person there. I hope that makes sense. So we want to be able to kind of abstract any spatial information that we have so that people are protected. And we really want to be asking this question in a manner of, people are already being harmed by police. Doing this work should not re-harm those folks. And so how can we still use all of this data that we're getting without revealing information about particular people? So here is an example of taking a city and anonymizing those census block groups. So this map is showing the actual latitude, longitude, and how this map is broken up into census block groups. And we want to then take that same information, maintaining the spatial like topology of everything and the sizes of those areas, but anonymizing it so that someone could not say, oh yeah, I know that town and I know who lives in that particular block group, right? We want to be able to abstract that. So Anna Haensch has done some great work in kind of blockifying and anonymizing these maps. And then another question comes up of, given anonymous data or even missing data, how can we then infer new things? So here's an example from Open Minneapolis. This is a map of Minneapolis. The data is widely available, but is only anonymized to the block level. So if something is happening at house A and house B on the same block, you wouldn't know. It's all kind of agglomerated into one. And we want to be able to take information that is not perfect or is missing, and to be able to still infer things from that. So one thing that we really wanted to look at that seems like an obvious question is looking at different demographics and how police are interacting with people of different demographics. So that data is not actually available in our data set. If we have calls going out to police, we don't know like who's making that call. We don't know their income, we don't know their race, we don't know their age. And so we want to be able to find that missing data from a different source and be able to statistically infer who that person might be, or how people are being served by the police, I should say. So again, work done by Anna. We have here the census block groups of our small town anonymized into this nice like blockified thing. So we have, you know, this anonymous town, and we can get information from the census about who lives there, and we know percentage of white or non-white and percentage, like different income levels and things like this. And so here we have just showing like where people of different demographics live. And we know from our data as well where calls are being placed to the police. So someone calls 911, they don't know who you are, but they know where you are. All of this information is saved, and we can map it out onto these census blocks, right? So we have all of these calls. Statistically, we can infer, given your white or non-white status and your high or not high income status, how many calls are being placed by what type of people outward to the police. So this is going to tell us how the police are serving the public. So here we have the results of that, and we can see that people who are non-white are much less likely to be placing calls to the police across this small town. This is just one particular set of data. And people who are low income are also less likely to be placing calls out to the police. So this tells us a lot about how the police are serving their public, whether it's how comfortable people are calling the police or how they are responded to when they are called. We can see that people are just not reaching out to the police. This has nothing to do with traffic stops or how the police are interacting with the public on their own accord. This is just how many people are calling the police. And this is really interesting as a start to look at how police are interacting with the public and how people are utilizing that service, because we had no information, I will just repeat, no information actually connected in our data set to people's demographics. This is getting demographics from a completely different source and then being able to infer what's happening in the small town. Okay, so given all of these things, we've kind of shown you a few examples of what we've done. All of this code is up and available, but really this is nothing if it just sits on a code repository. We really need to do something about it. And so I'm gonna kind of make a call to action, like what can you do in this case? If you're interested in getting involved in this, how can you do that? The first thing that I'm gonna say is just, of course, get your own policing data, especially if you live in a smaller town. I would absolutely love if you come talk to me at the end of the talk and just tell me, hey, I live here, can you please help me get policing data? Because this will help us build this repository and be able to kind of understand more about how people are being policed. So create and share new knowledge. So we have two papers that have kind of come out of this. I'll link those in a QR code at the end if you're interested in looking at that. But just doing research, if the data is already available, it's very easy to just scrape from your own if you live in a big city, or getting more data if you can. If you're interested, you can join something like a research lab. So the lab that I co-direct always wants new people. If you have data science skills, this is like super important to us, and you can just join and help us analyze more data. You can also partner with your own communities. So this is super important to me. If you go through and look at a small town in the abstract, there's almost no information that you can understand without that community context. So if you're interested in doing this work and you're going to look at someone else's city that you've never been to, you should connect with communities and involve them in all of your work, because this will help guide it and make it actually impactful. And then of course, the last step would be to advocate for policy change. So even if this is all done, if you present your community with some data or a toolkit or something like that, that's great. But if nothing happens from it, if you never go to your police departments and say, hey, this is what we're seeing, you need to change, or go to your legislators and tell them how the laws need to be changed, then nothing's gonna come from it. Okay, thank you so much for listening. I would like to just point you to our repository and our papers if you're interested in learning more about this. And I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Okay, people in person, please raise your hands. And then Anna's gonna be reading online questions if we get any.
So we have a question from Steph Buongiorno, who asks, I'll read the whole question. Steph says, thanks for walking us through the steps of obtaining this police report data. I wanted to collect police report data on Austin, Texas, because despite being a large metropolitan area, Austin doesn't have good public information on this topic. The police department kept referring me to 311 and never obtained the data. So two questions. What types of actionable steps do you think can be made, thanks to this data, to address policy changes? And a second question, where can we find your GitHub repo?
GitHub repo is here. There's also like a nice GitHub pages that has a full explanation of what we're doing. And then the first question, that's a great question. So part of it is addressing, if the data is not available, really the only thing you can do is remind the police that you're legally entitled to this data. Like you just have to keep being persistent. I think it took our collaborators on the order of a year and a half to actually get even their police department that wanted to comply to fully deliver the data. So be persistent and escalate. There are like legislators, there's your state attorney general that you can contact. And especially if you have good reason to be wanting this data and you say, I'm a data scientist, I really know what to do with this. They should want to help you, I hope. So that's my advice, is just keep escalating, keeping persistent. And then the second part of the question was about policy. I would say, definitely look at your communities and see what's happening. There is so much that's known at a not like research hard knowledge level that just communities know inherently. Go talk to people. Like, if you're worried about policing in your community, go talk about their experiences. Go ask folks, like, what are you seeing, you know, in your neighborhood? How are you being interacted with by the police? And that will help you formulate those questions. And once you can kind of get your data and answer them, that will inform the policy changes that need to happen.
In the cases where data was very difficult to get because it wasn't like digitally available or in a friendly format, have you given data back to those sources to show them, hey, this is what it could be, to maybe help them? And then have you had any follow-ups trying to get like refreshed data afterwards?
Yeah, so in terms of giving data back to those original sources, that's such a great point. That is something that we're still kind of like working on. We're really still at this small bubble of like case studies and then moving outward. But that's super important to then be able to say like, okay, this is what we found. And especially higher insights, even just like a quick dashboard of like statistically, like here's how many calls you've responded to. Here's like, you know, quick insights that are super fast to code up are really good to give back to the police departments, especially if they're friendly and they want to know that stuff. And then in terms of getting more data, I have been hesitant to really ask for more because it was such an endeavor for them to be able to give it to us. It really was a heavy lift and it did take like a lot of effort for someone. I think like literally someone was hitting print again and again on each individual page. So unless there's like a significant reason why we should be looking at next year's data, for example, I would be hesitant to like ask them to do that. Because legally they have to, but you don't want to be, you know, a burden. Thank you.
Hi, great talk. I work as a firefighter EMT, and obviously very different public perceptions of my job versus police and very different problems. But our jobs are also very intertwined. Like, I can't do my job in many parts of my town without police. So even if you call for medical assistance, police get dispatched first. I sit on the corner for 10, 15 minutes. So, and in small towns, it's the same dispatcher handling police, fire, EMS. So I'm curious if you've thought about or tried to get fire and EMS data, if HIPAA is blocking you on that as well, or future work for that?
Yeah, that's a great idea, great question. I actually haven't looked into that at all. I think that there is a good amount of data within the actual police data set that will say we connected with the fire department or we, you know, we left this to them, but I haven't actually thought about getting any more data. It seems like everything's been so messy and like abstract, it's like, well, I can't handle it. But that's a really good point that bringing in more information would also be super helpful.
Again, cool talk, normal comment for that. I was just wondering what software you used for the spatial weights that you were using in about the middle of your presentation and the region building for that.
Are you talking about like the anonymized map?
Yes.
I think that's done in R.
You should look into PyCell.
Okay.
Shameless plug.
We have one in the back, but I have to walk back over there, so.
Okay.
Hi. Is there any effort at the national level to set standards for how police should make this data available, or like state level, national level?
Yeah, that's a great question. So there are actually laws in place that the data does have to be digitally available. And I don't know what the like bare minimum, I haven't read the rules, but there is a standard that is almost impossible to just be met by these small towns. So I think that in the state that we gathered this data from, it was in the writ of law that it had to be digitally available to anyone, and just it was not feasible because it would have had to take someone translating all of that data and, you know, hiring probably an outside consultant and all these things that are prohibitive for that space. Yeah. So it exists. It should probably be more enforced, but.
Great. So I work on a team that does a lot of the step where you took the scanned PDFs and tries to turn it into a data set. Sounds like your experience was surprisingly rosy. and I'm just kind of curious if you have considered making both the raw reports and the transcribed data available as a training set for methods that are, you know, like layout parser that use these more modern techniques.
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm glad that you think it was rosy because it didn't feel rosy. But yes, it is openly available. All of the data, I think both the original PDFs, I'm not sure if the intermediate text logs are available, but you can play with our code and make just the like output available as well. And then we have just a bunch of cleaning up scripts that you can see for each different function, like what it's doing. So on our repository, everything's there. So please, I would love to connect and learn more about how to make it easier to do that stuff. And also building a more adaptable toolkit, because we hacked it for how we needed to do it, but to be able to say, oh, here's the package, you know, you can look at their documentation and do it better. That would be great.
Thanks so much, Ariana. Thanks for a wonderful talk. Thank you for your kind and thoughtful questions. So let's give another round of applause.